Robin Radar Systems provide you with a complete overview of bird and drone activity on and around your aerodrome. Our bird radars provide you with the actionable information you need to take control of your bird hazard issue. With both tactical and strategic data on offer, you'll be able to mitigate and prevent high-risk bird activity more accurately and with less effort than before. Increase safety while reducing bird strike incidents and expensive claims. Our drone detection systems enable you to take early control of drone hazards as they develop. Coordinate drone incidents with confidence and share clear and accurate threat location information with law enforcement agencies and other stakeholders. Reduce costly disruption and delays while increasing safety and security. Subscription-based pricing options available. Get in touch with us to find out more.
At Moog, we understand how costly foreign object debris can be, which is why we offer the Tarsier Automatic Runway FOD Detection System. In the 11 years since Tarsier was created, it has helped ensure 6 million plus FOD-free operations. It's the United States military's system of choice for FOD detection, and it can function in any and all weather conditions. The difference between Tarsier and manual FOD inspections is easy to see. Tarsier has proven that it detects all the FOD all the time, while manual inspections may miss items due to lighting conditions or the speed of a vehicle inspection. For over 65 years, Moog has been servicing the aircraft industry with innovative products and solutions. With the Tarsier Runway FOD Detection System, we're providing a solution that can generate revenue for your airport, prevent costly airport damage and lawsuits, and improve safety. Contact us.
Powerful solution to the FOD problem, AFOD is an electro-optical detection system supported with artificial intelligence, which is built to prevent the damage to airplanes and airports caused by foreign objects. Thoroughly inspecting airport runways, AFOD provides a constant flow of images and information to a central unit located at the control tower to be further processed by advanced AFOD algorithms. AFOD serves four main functions. By continuously inspecting airport runways, it detects FOD, specifying their location, size, number, and type of material. It also identifies wildlife presence, providing information as detailed as the species of the animal detected. It detects cracks and accumulation areas. It measures the depth of snow and thickness of ice.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this, the closing session of the FOD drone habitat and safety sessions, which today we'll be looking at FOD and safety on the ground. My name is John Hamshare, and it's my pleasure to introduce. We have Jonathan Sides from NAVAIR, Liam Bolger from London Luton Airport, Jarin Horton from Dallas Fort Worth, and Yunus Somnez from ArgosAI. If you'd like to ask a question at any time, please use the stage chat to your right of your screen, and we'll aim to respond to all those questions. Hopefully, at the end of each presentation, we'll take any questions that have come in, but if we don't have time to deal with them today, we'll certainly get the answers to you. You can also communicate with one another in private or public groups of up to six people using the front row networking tool on the bottom right of your screen. First up today, we have Jonathan Sides. Jonathan is the Chief Engineer for FOD Naval Air Systems Command NAVAIR Propulsion and Power Engineering at Naval Air Station Patuxent River. He leads a number of strategic P&P initiatives, including technology transition and project management and development programs. And having spent most of his career with propulsion and power, serving as the lead engineer for the Pegasus engine and as the IPT lead for the Legacy Hornet engine. Most recently, he was the senior design engineer for turbofan turbojet engines in the US Navy. Jonathan's going to talk to us today about foreign object damage reduction. Over to you, Jonathan.
Thank you, John. Appreciate the introduction, and I'm really happy to be back with you all again this year. It's I can't believe it's actually been a year since I last spoke with you all. So today, got some updates to the presentation that I've provided in the past, and some opportunities moving forward for the audience at large. I think you guys are going to share my presentation for me, though, since I'm working at the on the downside of Navy IT systems, unfortunately, these days. So last year, spent a lot of time talking to everybody about what the Navy and Marine Corps is doing to really change the way we think about FOD, and really moving away from what we call these Gen 1 FOD mitigation techniques, where you go out and you have FOD walks and you look for debris and you talk about what you did the night before and end up missing a whole bunch of stuff. And ultimately, it turns out that the operational tempo associated with FOD walks is insufficient to really mitigate debris ingestion in aircraft. And that's true for the civil aviation and military aviation communities. So what we're now working on is a next generation, what we kind of call a Gen 5 approach to dealing with FOD, one that implements high technology solutions and integrates them all together in a machine learning, artificial intelligence sort of a manner. And initial results that we're getting out of this are extremely positive as we demonstrate capability at Marine Corps Air Station Yuma, and we're ultimately going to be putting this in at NAS Lemoore, Naval Air Station Lemoore, which is in California. So I'm going to go through what our overall program is, what the cost benefit analysis of that is, what our technologies are, and then ultimately I want to spend a little more time on what our governance structure is in terms of working groups and where we're looking for participation from a larger community beyond the core. So if you go on to the next slide. We talk about what for the military and civil aviation community is. And these numbers are staggering. $150 million a year for Navy and Marine Corps. It does not include the U.S. Air Force. And it's really only including what I would say is our tactical aircraft, basically your go-fast airplanes, because they're the ones that use turbofans and turbojets. For the civil aviation community, we conservatively estimated about $2 billion a year, and we're basing that off of our P-8 fleet, our Poseidon fleet, which is basically a modified 737, and then extrapolated those numbers to what we were seeing in terms of movements for the civil aviation community. This is an area that we still would love to get some additional feedback and coordination with our civil aviation folks to understand, is this indeed an accurate number? And we've been asking this for a while. I think it's a difficult number for folks to get a handle on. And more importantly, is it a relevant metric? What does the civil aviation community really care about? I would expect it's probably going to be something more on the order of readiness, but would really like to get some feedback on that. So just, you know, it's just a quick reminder as to what this is costing. And then, of course, we're not talking about readiness just yet, but we will. what are we doing? I talked about moving from a Gen 1 to a Gen 5. So if you go to the next slide, we've really broken our program into three components, and they're all operating in parallel. Augment our existing capability. In other words, provide better solution sets for mitigating debris on our airfield. Then move on to what's really the interesting part of this, which is how do we begin to understand the information? How do we understand what the airfield looks like when aircraft are actually ingesting debris, and then put all of that information about the environment together to come up with a correlative analysis that says, if these range of variables are aligned, you are going to have a FOD event, and then put in place mitigations to prevent that from happening in the first place. So it's a really a proactive approach to solving FOD. And then also in parallel is, once you understand how to mitigate your FOD, how do you begin to automate those solution sets? How do you, instead of burdening a human being with trying to sort through mountains and mountains of data, even if it is distilled through AI algorithms, how do you just automate machines to go out and either clean the airfield, or maybe you make automated ATC changes? You say, hey, instead of taking off of runway 23 left, we're going to be operating off of runway 11 because that runway is damaged. So lots of potential there, and this forms the basis of our program. And you can see some of the components there too, that which we could spend hours discussing all on their own. If you go to the next slide, and I apologize if I'm going fast, I recognize I only have about 15 minutes to go through a lot of material. But slide number 4 is really focused on what this solution set looks like. And many of you have seen this slide, so I won't spend too much time on it. But what you should take away from it is that it is an integrated solution. It is an airfield integrated solution that brings many sensor suites and kind of an Internet of Things together, and then distills all that information into either edge processing or centralized AI processing in order to inform the user as to how to mitigate FOD. The beauty of this system is that we're developing it to be an open architecture system, one that you can then begin integrating other things into it that are not just FOD. This is obviously, a lot of people are very interested in counter UAS for the military. We're concerned about counter incursion as well. And the list will go on in terms of other things that you can integrate onto an airfield. So really what we're developing is, in addition to the FOD system of systems, an architecture that enables lots of next generation capabilities for moving information across an airfield. If you move on to the next slide, I use this slide more for my leadership in the Navy when they say, why are we doing something? Why do we need to do something about this problem now? And why can't we just keep doing what we've been doing? And I would imagine the corollary for the civil aviation community is going to be very similar. The bottom line is, if all you do are what we call brute force methods, improve upon the way that you just eliminate debris from the airfield, then you're really just going to see a very small shift in your FOD costs. It's really that gray line there. If you want to see a fundamental shift in the way that we experience FOD, then you're going to have to go to a new solution set, and that's what we're proposing. And this slide really highlights that benefit. All right, so swiftly moving along, we'll skip two slides. To our technical solutions, and we'll talk a little bit about the Moog radar towers, who they are a sponsor of the FDH&S. And I do want to be very clear, as a government representative, I'm not endorsing one solution set or another. Now that my lawyer is happy, I do want to talk about what we've been seeing at Yuma, though. And we've had some very, very good success initially with what we call the first order effects of the radar system, which is what the radar physically sees. So if you go to the next slide, you can see a snapshot of the data that was collected on one day. This is just one day at Marine Corps Air Station Yuma. And what you'll notice is that you've got lots and lots of little green donuts in the upper right-hand corner of that airfield. And what was very interesting about that day is that we had Osprey operations, and Ospreys are the tilt rotor helicopter aircraft. They're basically a vertical and takeoff landing aircraft. And so when they come in to land, they'll come in and they'll basically come approach like they're landing normally, and then they'll cross over to a hover pad. And what we saw from that operations, and this is no shock to anybody, is that look at all the debris that collected on hover pad four over there when they did those operations. We were then able to inform the airfield manager that we had all this debris, and they suspended F-35 operations while they had the opportunity to clean that airfield up. That's a capability that did not exist before we had this radar system. Now, ultimately, and this is a question that we had received from the FAA, and it was a very good question, they said, well, that's great, but you're talking about hundreds, if not thousands, of hits at any given time. How are you going to mitigate that with day-to-day operations? And the answer is, no human being, once this is integrated into our complete system, is ever going to look at this data. This data is ultimately going to be sorted into an AI algorithm, and you're going to get a risk profile that says you're good to go, or you need to go, you need to move and do something differently, or you need to clean. But ultimately, that's going to be informed by data. And we can talk about that more later, but take away from this, even though you're seeing lots of little dots, it doesn't mean that you necessarily have to do anything about them. Next slide, we're just going to briefly touch it. And I throw this on here because it gives a really good idea of the type of debris that this radar system is detecting. From about 700 meters away, you're able to see debris that small. So you're talking 3 to 4 millimeters. And this is from my own personal experience. We were out on the airfield. That's debris that I actually picked up based off the radar signatures that we saw. These are not the kinds of things you're going to pick up on a FOD walk ever. But these are the kinds of things that damage engines. So that's what we have from a capability perspective. The next couple of slides talks about some of our brute force equipment, the FOD blowers. These are great machines. We were able to implement these and actually clean our entire airfield within hours, where with a regular FOD sweeper, it would take us over a week to actually cover an entire airfield. And now we're able to do it every day. And that's shown us that persistence in cleaning airfields has a much greater impact than just going out there with a sweeper and just hoping that you're going to get everything as slowly as that takes. So this has been a big benefit for us. Another technology that we're looking at, if you go to the next slide, are FOD barriers, like little scuppers, basically. And these are, we haven't been able to test them yet, but we intend to implement them at Yuma and Lemoore. But the idea is that you blow debris over these things and then they can't get back onto the airfield. Great for desert environments like Yuma and Lemoore, anywhere where you have a rocky infield that you can't protect against. This is the type of solution that you want to have. And of course, these are all frangible. So if you run them over, you're not going to damage your aircraft. I'm not trying to sell this to you, I promise. But this is a technology that we're about to evaluate within the military. And then the last technology on the next slide that I want to address is one that I'm particularly excited about, which is this vision AI. Again, nothing monumental, but it does potentially represent a shift in how we evaluate pavement condition. Moving away from a qualitative pavement condition inspection report, which for the Navy and Marine Corps happens about every 3 years, we would transition to something where we're able to measure the condition of the airfield every time a vehicle passes over it. Integrate that, track the actual degradation of the pavement in near real time, and then produce an estimate of what that damage is, and then ultimately correlate it to the FOD events that we have. Those repairs that you may think are critical to make because you think that they affect FOD may not be affecting FOD. This sort of information is the kind of thing that's going to help us make those informed decisions. And really, there's a lot of potential here. Again, I could go on about this for quite some time, but I'm recognize that I'm very, very short on it. So we'll move on to the last part of the presentation, which is the governance and implementation side. Next slide. By the way, this presentation is open for everybody. I can share it. If you shoot me an email later, you can have it. But one thing that I want to really quickly highlight is that everybody experiences the problem of FOD differently in terms of how it hits their pocketbooks. And this is just a quick summary of how that is. Military and civil own the problem differently. On a military side, we own everything. From a civil aviation side, you guys only own portions of it. So that's kind of an important takeaway in terms of when we talk about how we're going to solve the problem in a joint way. You know, next slide is why it's important. I'm not going to focus on this one. Please ask me for the slide, but these are the key areas. You know, we want to have lots and lots of participation so that we can ultimately field a sustainable solution, one that's nearly universal, or at least something that we can pick and choose from to tailor solutions to everybody. If you go to the next slide, what we've done in the Navy, because we have a very large bureaucracy, is we've established what we call a joint FOD program office, and it's comprised of these organizations you have on the left. For those of you who are not in the military, this is going to sound very impressive, but this was actually endorsed at the 3-star level for each one of these organizations. That's how seriously the Navy and Marine Corps takes this. I am the chair of this FOD working group, and what I'd like to do is I'd actually like to expand it to include all of the folks on the right. I would like it to be a DOD working group, but as well as one that includes the civil aviation community, to include the FAA as well as industry partners. Now, there's different ways that we can do this, and what I'm going to propose in the next slide is maybe a hybrid approach to establishing a working group that can then bring in the requirements of the entire community. And so what I'm proposing is that we establish a joint aviation community FOD working group that's independent of the military FOD working group for the time being. And the benefit of that will be that we'll be able to have all of the stakeholders present, everybody who feels the pain of FOD in their pocketbook or from a readiness perspective, and understand what the true requirements are for solving this problem. You know, Dallas-Fort Worth is on today. You know, the issues that Dallas-Fort Worth is having are not going to be the same issues that Lemoore is having. So how do you feel those pains, and what can we do about it moving forward? So what we're proposing is that there's a few meetings that are coming up. There's AAAE and the AA&I conference in June primarily in June. I think it's actually also, there's another one in July. And we'd like to establish probably the first sessions of what we're going to call a joint FOD working group. And so we'd be very interested in having anybody who feels like they are a stakeholder involved in this. Ahead of that meeting, we will put together a draft charter. It'll look very similar to what we have for everybody to review. And what we'll do in the first meeting is we will establish what the charter of this working group should look like, and then move on to solving the problems of FOD. So unfortunately, I'm at the end of my 15 minutes. I know that was kind of a shotgun approach, lots of things to discuss. Please do not hesitate to reach out to me directly. I think John has my contact information if it's not in this brief. It actually would not be in this brief since this is releasable. Love to field any questions that you may have if we have time for that.
Thanks, Jonathan. I think we have time for one quick question. And that's a question to you about risk categorization of FOD. We wondered if you've ever applied a risk classification system to your FOD found at any locations.
So the way that we intend to address risk is not actually from the perspective of size or what it is, but it's really going to be based on the probability of all of the variables put together and whether or not that results in an ingestion event. And that ingestion event will be measured through what we have our inlet debris monitoring systems that we're developing. So it's really bringing together all of this information, because in the end, what we found as an anecdote is very, very small debris, like the non-skid that we have on our ships, things that people thought would never actually harm an aircraft engine, caused massive damage. And you never would have found those things. So really, it's very difficult to look at something. Somebody might say a wrench is high risk, but I don't know of any scenarios where we've actually ingested a wrench unless it's been left in the inlet. It doesn't, we don't pick those things up off the ground. So it's really going to be a function of what the data is showing us and when we have a high probability of ingesting something and then taking a look at what all the environmental factors were that played into that event. That's how we're going to address risk. Hopefully that answers the question.
That's great. Thank you. I think we need to move on. There is one other question, but we'll pick that up later. So thank you, Jonathan. I'd like to now introduce Liam Bolger from Luton Airport. Liam is the head of airside operations at Luton and has covered a wide variety of operational roles in his 32 years of aviation experience, because he joined when he was 10, ranging from ramp services to terminal duty manager, airport manager, and airside operations. In the past 5 years, he's been working with a multi-skilled team of colleagues encompassed in a single operational department, air ops, where areas covered include flight ops, compliance, safeguarding, emergency, and crisis management. Liam's going to talk about FOD reporting. Over to you, Liam.
Thanks, John. I thought I'd save you all a presentation of the aftermath of FOD incidents because it serves very little. You can Google that anytime you like. What I really wanted to do was really share some of my experience in the airside environment and perhaps some things that you might take away today and can apply yourself that would mitigate your FOD risk. So, you know, I think great presentation from Jonathan. FOD radar, you know, will be suitable to some people in very large airport environments, and for some, maybe not so affordable, but there are things that you can do aside from that that would certainly significantly reduce any FOD risk that you have and improve that situation. And I guess really, first of all, you know, the question is, why should we be that interested? Well, I attended a meeting back in 2018, just before COVID came in, who thought that would happen, but an insurance company did a presentation, and what they had been doing for years was underinsuring jet engines. And they were insuring a jet engine at around 2.5 to 3 million, when in fact, jet engines had come a long way. And if you look at something like a NEO engine, you're talking 10 million. So very much underinsured and very much a focus on where it hadn't been previously, but very much took a focus on airports. And could you demonstrate that you were doing what you were meant to be doing to prevent damage, whether that's wildlife strike or any other type of FOD? And let's be clear that, you know, humans fall into that category just as well as wildlife and as well as any other debris that you have around your airport. So where insurance companies were very happy to, you know, swallow the tablet and pay up, not so much anymore. And that you would find that if there was a serious FOD damage incident, that you would probably have investigators from the insurance company coming to pay a visit to have a look and see what you were doing to prevent it. So a real good motivation, because it's a very expensive undertaking. And you know, aside from that, can be lethal if you're not paying attention and you're not doing things correctly. So, you know, we see that engine ingestion of humans is very rare, but actually, if you look at the people that ultimately get ingested, it's mostly amongst engineers, people who should know what they're doing, but, you know, complacency sets in. We think we know things, and we forget little missteps that we make over time we just erode different processes and procedures, and we lose sight of what we're actually doing. We lose sight of that, and I think there's a few things for me when I first was introduced to the airfield was just looking around generally at housekeeping, and when I came around first, you know, yes, we were doing all of those things like sweeping and maintaining the taxiways and looking after the runway and doing those inspections, but the rest of the place wasn't so good. There was a lot of debris around. And if we want to liken this to, say, the behavioral aspect of it and look at that, you know, if you go into a five-star hotel, nobody has to tell you what the behavioral expectation is there. I keep getting a call here, which is very distracting. So if you go into a five-star hotel, and you will know the expectation. Nobody's going to need to point that out to you. You can't avoid that. And if you don't wish to behave in that way, you'll probably be asked to leave. You know, when I looked at our airfield environment to begin with, I wondered what expectation people might have as to the behavioral standard on our airfield. And if I was totally honest about it, I would say probably quite low, because, you know, vehicles were damaged. There was a lot of pallets laying around, you know, there was FOD in vehicles. There was all of these sort of things that sort of, there was a mismatch, you know. So very clean taxiways, apron stands kept probably reasonably well, not as good maybe as they could have been, but there was two sorts of behavioral sets, and one would drive the behavior mostly was that, you know, the housekeeping wasn't great. So one of the things that we set about here doing was actually cleaning house and creating an environment where people who would come onto the airfield would know exactly what to expect and how to behave in that airfield, and that it wouldn't be acceptable to just leave a pallet behind you or leave debris in a baggage trailer or on the back of a flatbed truck or whatever. So really it was about creating that environment, and that extended right across the airfield. We did the same thing across wildlife, because your wildlife strike, you know, that's FOD as well, and a significant risk of that. We're surrounded ourselves by about two-thirds of our boundary is arable farmland. So what do we do about that? And when we went out and looked at that, you know, we had large areas of scrubland, and we decided way back then that we would take all of that and create what we called a sterile airfield environment. And we've done that very successfully. And we have, you know, very few FOD incidents. We still have them, of course. And you know, it's never over. Some people come along to look at some of the things that we have done, and they expect to walk away with a piece of paper that says, you know, if you do X, Y, and Z, problems resolved. And it's not. The problem's different for every airport, and it's different for all of us. There's some very common things that we have, like housekeeping, that we can all do. Some airports will require FOD radar because it's just too big and too busy to really be able to carry out continuous inspection. And these are the things that we looked at. You know, high wind inspections, you know, most airports have high wind inspections, but what do they think about after high wind inspections? So when that threat passes, and the weather dies down, you know, the one thing that you will find that you will have hot spots in your airport where FOD collects every time, you know, and high winds is a high risk time. And it's not just about your pavements then and your own infrastructure. What about the infrastructure that's sitting around your airfield? So we've got a lot of farmland. We've got some farming sheds not very far away from the runway. You know, what's happening there in high winds, and what's the risk of FOD coming onto your airfield that way? And all of these things that we really spent a lot of time looking at, we definitely had to proceduralize quite a lot of them. But, you know, you can have all the paperwork in the world. If you don't have the regime, and if you don't have people on board and focused on that, you know, the paperwork won't save you. That's for certain. So one of the things that I will share, and I will bring this to a close fairly quick because we're already running behind, is that, you know, I was once asked by a lady I brought in here to do some leadership training, and she said, you know, how many brains do you have in your department? And I thought that was an interesting question. So I told her, and I think at the time it was around 42, it's quite a few years ago. And she said, how many do you use? And I thought that was an even better question, because when you really got down to it, four or five, and everybody else was just there to do the mechanical stuff, but you relied on those four or five people. Well, for most of us, our airside environments are quite large. We have thousands of people that operate in those environments. And what I would say, and one of the things that we did quite successfully, was we engaged a lot of those brains in assisting with FOD mitigation, along with other safety events, not just FOD, but a whole host of those, because it would just seem pointless to have a small team of people trying to manage all of that on their own, when actually the resource available is quite extensive. And this is one of the ways that we approached it. And there's something that you can do tomorrow. You can, you know, look at your airfield with fresh eyes, see what your FOD hazard risk is, and then see what resource you need to apply to that and what help you can get from the broader community, because most people are willing to help if you ask. And I think that was one of the big ones for us. And we certainly pride ourselves in keeping an airfield that we would expect everybody to respect, and that anybody that would step foot on the airfield would know that it's definitely managed, and that there will be an expectation that, you know, the behaviors in that airfield meet with the environment that you're walking through. And we've done that, and I think we've done that well. And I've seen a lot of other airports do the same thing. You know, we don't do FOD walks because we think this is a thing that you do every day. I know I see a lot of stuff online where, you know, people have gone out on a FOD walk, they're all with their black bin bags. It's once a month or once a quarter, or maybe just every now and again. And they're all very happy that they've done it and they've gathered up a bit of rubbish. But, you know, that's once in a blue moon is not going to do it, really. It's something that you must do all of the time and every day. And I think, you know, I see one of the questions here. Have we seen a notable change in general attitudes of airside workers in relation to FOD? Absolutely. Absolutely we have. And the reporting. And just by engaging these people, you know, I would say that, you know, our reporting has shot up thousands of percent since around 2014. When we really started to get people engaged, we got much, much better reporting. But this is, you know, these are the things, these are the tools that you have at your hands every day, and you should use them. And you know, you go out and you look in vehicles, and for the most part, they're clean and they're tidy and people have an awareness. Are they all going to play a game with you? Are they all going to play along? Absolutely not. No, they're not. But if you get enough of them, if you've only got 10% of your entire airside community working alongside you, isn't that something compared to having a handful, a little department of safety officers? And that's what you need to look at. And when you start to add these things to things like FOD radar, you know, Craigie, you know, you're on steroids then. You know, you're doing a really good job then. So that's it for me, John. I think, you know, I don't know if there's any other questions there that are pressing.
No, thanks, Liam. No. You've answered that question that we had about attitude. I was going to expand a bit on that, but I won't waste any more everyone's time. Thanks, Liam. That's really interesting. Thank you very much.
Right. No worries, John.
I'd like to introduce Jarin Horton next. Jarin is currently the Assistant Vice President of the Airfield Operations at Dallas-Fort Worth International Airport. Having previously worked at Hartsfield-Jackson-Atlanta International Airport, Memphis International Airport, and Philadelphia International Airport in operations and security. He's an accredited airport executive from the AAAE, and Jarin graduated from the Florida Institute of Technology and earned an MBA from the Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University, as well as going on to work as a commercial pilot. Jarin's going to talk about safety on the ground. Over to you, Jarin.
All right, thank you, John. Great presentations by Jonathan and Liam. So like you said, I'm with the Dallas-Fort Worth International Airport. I've only been here about 6 months, so I'm relatively new to this environment, but I do have experience at other airports. So I kind of broke this presentation up into two different parts, the first part being safety, and then I'll tie that into FOD at the end of the presentation. Right. So Dallas-Fort Worth is jointly owned by the cities of Dallas and Fort Worth, but it's operated by a DFW board. So I'm not a government employee. We are operated separately from the two cities. There's just kind of an aerial of the airport. If you're not familiar with it, we have five parallel north-south runways and then two diagonal runways for crosswind situations. And as you'll notice, if you can tell from this aerial, we have two asphalt runways, kind of a new thing for this airport. I decided the cost benefit analysis, going to asphalt on those, worked out better. So if you don't know, we're a class one large hub airport. There's 164 gates here at DFW, 193 domestic destinations, and 67 international destinations that are served nonstop. There's 22 cargo airlines, over 650,000 annual operations, which makes us the fourth busiest in the world in terms of operations, and we serve over 73 million passengers. I believe these are actually 2019 numbers. They are skewed from COVID. All right, here's some of the things I'll cover throughout the presentation. Like I said, starting with safety and moving into FOD at the end. So I'm sure all of you have heard of runway status lights. It's the first airport I've been at that actually has them. We looked at them at my previous airports, but never ended up getting them or are in the process at this point. Came here to DFW and they do have them. Find them very beneficial in terms of safety. There's no doubt that you're about to cross the runway when you see those lights. Clear indication to the pilots on the runway, whether or not they're cleared for takeoff or not, based on the light system. So I do find these very beneficial, especially for somebody that's out there all the time, just to see that visual indication of whether the runway is occupied or not, very useful. We also have gone to a runway incursion warning system. This is covered in one of the advisory circulars. DFW has taken this on a couple of years ago as an initiative to reduce runway incursions. Provides an audio and a visual warning to the operators of vehicles that they're about to enter an active runway. And we do this for all of our vehicles that are unescorted out on the movement area. So it's kind of a unique situation here at DFW. A lot of the vehicle roadways go throughout the movement area. So there are a lot of vehicles that operate in the movement area here at DFW. It's also very good for situational awareness. We view that in our, we call it our IOC. It's our Integrated Operations Center. It's kind of the nerve hub of DFW. So it's visual, and I'll show a graphic here in a minute. Visual to everybody operating on the airport. It's very helpful for incident reviews. If we have a alleged surface incident or a runway incursion, we can go back and review an incident, play it back. Also for winter weather vehicle tracking, very helpful to know where the different equipment is out on the airfield at one time, and you can easily track where we've been and where we're going next. Here is kind of a visual of that system. We just recently changed the color coding. All vehicles used to be the same color. It was very confusing. So we've kind of done different colors for different types of vehicles. The red being our fire trucks, blue being fire, gray maintenance, just helps purple FAA, just helps sort out the different vehicles out in the movement area. And so this is an active map. If you're watching it real time, you'll actually, you know, see the dots moving. It's pretty accurate within a few seconds of what's happening on the airfield. Here's what's in the vehicles. So some vehicles get a laptop or a tablet and helps them visually see what's going on in the airfield, similar to that map I just showed you. A lot of vehicles also have this this small bar that gives you a light indication and quite a loud audio warning when you're about to enter an active runway environment. So you get two greens if it's operating correctly, you get two yellows if you enter a 30-foot buffer of the whole short line, and then two reds if you're predicted to cross that runway whole bar. I'll zoom in a little on the next slide. So it's very noticeable, the lights, and like I said, the audio is also very noticeable when you're in the vehicle. Oh, that was a video. All right, so we have implemented all those. It was a two-year program that we're almost wrapped up with. Almost all of our vehicles now have those. We're in the final steps of install on those. Seems to be going very well, if that's something you're interested in. And we correlated a lot to our drop in runway incursions. So we keep track of these. These are FAA numbers. And you know, fiscal year 20 is when we started due to the increase in runway incursions that we've had. And we've since dropped that number down quite significantly. We attribute a lot of that to that program. All right, another thing we do here at DFW is the driving simulators. You know, I think we have five of these in our driver training program. Obviously not the same as really driving out there, but a very good second choice, if you will, for getting out. And, you know, the airfield is mapped completely, so you can, it's exactly DFW's layout, and very useful tool for practicing and getting practice out on the airfield without actually taking up people's time or equipment. All right, another thing we've done is end-around taxiways. This is an old image. We are planning on at least four end-around taxiways. The southeast end-arounds are already done. The northeast end-arounds are scheduled to be done later this week. So this portion on the north side is already done, but then this final eastern portion should be done later this week. And then we're looking to do other end-arounds as well to just help reduce those runway crossings. Time, good. All right, we also hosted a safety summit a couple of years ago. We had that, as you saw from that chart, a high incidence of runway incursions. And we were trying to just gather other airports from around the country, figure out what they were doing to help prevent runway incursions. We hosted it here at DFW, had a lot of good takeaways from that. Part of it was we installed some blue lines on our vehicle service roads, which I'll show a picture of in a minute, to help guide some of those vehicles that are operating out on the perimeter, keep them from accidentally making the wrong turn out towards the runways and taxiways. Also installed a red line, do not cross line, in multiple areas right next to the movement area line. Just another indication for vehicles that they're about to enter a active movement area. And we also started a notice of violation program where we issued points for individuals that have violated some of our driving rules. And before that NOV program, Ops was not providing that initial movement area driver training or enforcing the rules out there. We let the airlines and different tenants provide their own driver training. They had to produce the records for us, but we were not involved. So we took that part over to help give them a baseline of training. And then Ops, police used to enforce the rules, but now Ops is able to enforce the driving rules out on the airfield. All right, here's a, hopefully it's not too small, but the blue line I talked about around our perimeter roadway, it's kind of hard to see, but if you can tell, it goes down the center line of each road, just gives an indication for those vehicles operating in these cargo ramps as they come out to avoid driving straight out to the taxiways or God forbid straight out onto the runways. And also this red line, I think we borrowed this from another airport. This red line idea right next to the movement area, just another indication for people that aren't used to going out near that line, that they are not to cross the red line. All right, I'll start to tie it in the FOD a little here. So for our self-inspection program, we do a daily runway inspection starting in the morning, and we do four vehicles on the runway. So each vehicle has their own portion of the runway they're assigned to inspect, whether it's, you know, left of center line, right of center line, or on the edges, and part of the safety areas as well that they're looking at. It takes about an hour. It's quite, you know, quite intense. First of its kind that I've seen where that many vehicles are out there inspecting a runway. But it really does help to see all the things you might miss with a single vehicle or two vehicles. We do an evening inspection just looking for FOD on our departure runways. We did that a study on FOD as we were looking to get some of those FOD radars. And we noticed, you know, high levels of FOD in the evenings, a lot of times due to bird strikes. So we implemented those evening FOD inspections on our departure runways just to make sure we're gathering any FOD in those evening hours. And then our midnight inspections, we can focus, spend a lot more time out on there, it's not as much air traffic, and really gathering thing that's left over. Our ramps are also inspected multiple times a day. We do keep track of the FOD that's gathered out of this. This is just the January numbers I grabbed. Oh, real quick, that shows out of the 2,200 inspections, 27% of those inspections, we did find FOD during those inspections. All right, here's some of the equipment I've seen used. Has been very useful throughout my career. Part of that manual Gen 1 approach to removing FOD that Jonathan talked about. Actually manually out there, finding it, removing it, you know, from FOD walks. I agree with Liam's point that that's an everyday thing, but it does help raise awareness for those that don't get out there often enough to actually see what their job produces. And so that they go back to their shops and realize, hey, we gotta do better housekeeping at our airport. So we use several of these throughout different airports I've worked at. Just good ways to collect FOD manually out there. All right, this is straight from the advisory circular on ways to prevent FOD. I know all of you are probably very familiar with that, that it's really about the data you gather and doing something with it. So you can't just be removing it and never look at it again. So if you're really able to track what's happening out there, find those hot spots that Liam was talking about, really helps your program to get off the ground. All right, here's the AC. Just grabbed a screenshot for you to reference it. There's also a good ACRP on FOD programs. Like Liam had talked about, it's very important to talk about FOD regularly. Can't just be, you find it, you remove it, and nobody talks about what they're seeing. You know, we're looking for trends. We use a GIS mapping system. We're also looking at using drones to aid with our inspections, using some 4K cameras that really help pick up things that the human eye might miss. Oh. We've also done events like scavenger hunts just to make the FOD walk a little more interesting. Also safety awards and making sure we train our folks to be looking for FOD. Close to time. So I'll point out these were not found at DFW, but I think it helps point to a good FOD program. We were finding these parts at a previous airport. Didn't know what they were. Found them in clumps all over the airfield over the course of time. So we kept track of those and were coordinating with our tenants to try to figure out what the cause was. We, you know, tried to figure out if they were coming from mowers or from snow equipment, or aircraft. Did turn out to be part of a brake system of an aircraft that we only gathered by working with our tenants and gathering all this data on FOD to show them that here's what we're finding and please help us find the solution. So we were able to determine it was a brake part, and I think they're working on correcting that. Same thing happened with these aftermarket gas fuel caps. We found a lot of these regularly and realize, again, similar to the last incident, working with our tenants, realized that it was an aftermarket piece that they were able to solve, and the problem went away once we finally brought it to the attention of the airline. Just another image of that, what was being found out there. Like I said, multiple found throughout the course of a couple of years till we finally got to the root of the cause. All right, I think that's all my time. Appreciate it. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to take them.
Thank you, Jarin. That's very interesting. So I'll just have a couple of questions for you, Jarin, and before we move on to our panel closing questions and answers. In your driving simulator, do you use it with any specific scenarios built in? I'm thinking of things like aircraft accidents or disabled aircraft built into the system.
Yes, we do have multiple scenarios that can be run. Weather as well can be included into that. And we do have operators that are in the room with them serving as air traffic control. So they're actually talking live on the radio to a gentleman in the other room acting as air traffic.
Excellent. Yeah, that's really, really useful. And a quick question from me. Your do not cross painted sign.
Yes.
Have you had any difficulties or discussions with your regulators about applying those sorts of signs and markings, as they're not standard?
Correct. Yeah, they are not standard. FAA has not had any issues with them. They're on the non-movement side of the whole bar. And no, there's been no issues with the FAA on that.
Great. Thank you, Jarin. So we'll move on to our panel section now. And joining us is Yunus Somnez, who describes himself as being on a mission to support airports in their efforts to make flights safer and more efficient. He's trained as a mechanical engineer and holds an MBA degree, and at ArgosAI specializes in project management and digital transformation on energy and aviation projects. So first question to you, Yunus, how would an airport build a business case for incorporating AI to manage FOD detection?
Thank you very much for this question, John. Before answering, I would like to tell that we were planning to be here together with Istanbul Grand Airport. It will be a really nice case to tell our approach, but unfortunately we couldn't make it. I hope that next year we will be here together with them. To your question, I can say that we had developed our core product to detect FODs on the runway. It was something we had discovered as a problem need to be solved immediately to increase the safety of flight operations. On the other hand, upon the request of London Heathrow Airport about apron FOD detection system, we had adapted our current solution to this field. I think, John, you should remember the times during 2018 when London Heathrow got in contact with us. They visited our first reference project in Alanya Gazi Pasha International Airport. And then we decided to move on a special product for APRON. APRONs are heavily used areas by ground personnel and ground vehicles. Because of that, the rate of FOD occurrence in APRON area is very high. We developed our product successfully. In this case, I would like to emphasize the importance of feedbacks and requests of the airports for our approach. We are developing our products based on the needs of airports. With the initiation of Heathrow Airport, it was the first and only in the world where automated FOD detection was used in the apron area. Also, this process is valid for product upgrades. The changes and upgrades in the product features are always done based on airport's feedbacks. We have a certain focus to airfield inspection operations. As a young and dynamic company, I can easily say that we are very agile to upgrade our products and make them more comprehensive. Because of that, we will be very happy to hear the requests and feedbacks of airports.
That's great. Thank you, Yunus. This question is to all of you, so it might be a bit of a hands up if you want to answer. How do you undertake root cause analysis of events to understand, mitigate, and remove the risks such as FOD from occurring or recurring and the need to be found or detected?
Well, John, I'll have a go at that, you know, but I think one of the obvious things here is that, you know, first of all, is your data collection, so your inspections and to record what you're finding. And I guess then, you know, investigation after that, if, you know, what we do is we collect the data, and if we see a trend, we'll jump on it and just see what might be behind that. So we're not going to root cause analysis, analyze everything that we see one off, but certainly what we would look for is a pattern. And if we see one of those starting to emerge, then we just take that to the next level and look at, you know, what is sitting behind that. And very often, you know, it's not what you think. You know, one of the things that I think is, you know, if you're having a problem with FOD, you know, is it FOD that's really the problem? And generally not. You know, it's generally the people behind it. And then what sits behind that, and you know, you start going back and you start looking at leadership and you start looking at what are people doing to prevent those sort of incidents. And you know, you'll be surprised in all of these things that the airport's got a very strong focus on this type of thing, but maybe not carried forward by those parties that can affect it the most. And that's where you really need to focus your attention. Are these other individuals carrying the same message? Are you all on the same page or not? And very often, you know, when it comes to ground handling and stuff like that, you know, the page that they tend to be stuck on is the OTP page, and everything around that doesn't matter. And that's really where you have to make your inroads. But, you know, these guys are coming up with some very clever stuff that assists with that. And I think, you know, really, when you start to look at, you know, the use of drones going into the future, you know, I see a lot of development now with drones and AI. So drones for doing AGL inspections, but along with AI so that it can detect your faults and report them to you. So all of these things are in development. I think they're all very, very useful. And I think one of the things we definitely can't get away from, you know, we have to run the human alongside the technology. But when you combine the two, you can become really effective. But I think, you know, when we get into root cause analysis, I think, you know, you'll find that, you know, most of that stems back to what the human's doing, you know, or not.
Yeah, that makes sense. Thanks, Liam. And I'll say that's my experience too. So in terms of AI, perhaps a question to everyone again, and first come, first serve. What are the key day-to-day challenges for airports when trying to integrate AI, do you think?
Maybe I can take the floor again for this question. I think the biggest challenge is the actual way of manual inspections, because the current regulation recommends manual inspection is enough, 4 times a day, 15 minutes minimum. In some airports with high frequency and limited runways, this situation poses serious operational and safety risks. All of us know how the manual inspections are done. Openly speaking, it's very primitive. Four ground personnel are sitting in a follow me vehicle. They are trying to check the runway if there's any FOD or not. Openly speaking, the rate of detected FODs by human eye is very, very low. On the other hand, we are developing a product with artificial intelligence, which is capable to realize root analysis, which is capable to make a risk categorization, which can learn from the experiences. But the current regulation do not expect the automated FOD detection system. It means that even if an airport installs an automated FOD detection system, they must continue manual inspections to fulfill their responsibilities against regulations, unless they do not have a written consent of the CAA. In this case, there is a very straightforward choice for the airports. The airports generally are not willing to install an additional decision support mechanism, even if it is better than the manual inspection, because the regulation doesn't support it, actually. I think it is the biggest barrier, biggest challenge for the airports. Because of that, the biggest key challenges are related with the regulation. In order to have a widely used high technologies, they must be supported by the regulations. Unfortunately, I should say that what we are, as a technology provider, what we are doing this to overcome, we are trying to convince the airport about the economical viability of the system. However, it's a safety system, actually. And I think its procurement of such a system should be considered because of its contribution to safety, even without discussing the economics.
Thank you, Yunus. I think we're very close to running out of time, so I'll thank you all again for your presentations and for thank you, Jonathan, Liam, Jarin, and Yunus for your contributions today. Excellent. I'd also like to thank our sponsors, our session sponsors, ArgosAI, the sponsors for today of Moog, and the series sponsors, Robin Radar. We're going to take a short break now, be back by 5:30 for birds, drones, and safety in the air, where I'll be joined by Gary Searing from the Bird Strike Association of Canada, San Patjin from Robin Radar, who's a former manager of bird control at Schiphol, and Ben Harrison from London City Airport. So I'd just like to say thank you all for attending. Thanks again to the panel, and we'll see you in about 1/4 hour. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Robin Radar systems provide you with a complete overview of bird and drone activity on and around your aerodrome. Our bird radars provide you with the actionable information you need to take control of your bird hazard issue. With both tactical and strategic data on offer, you'll be able to mitigate and prevent high-risk bird activity more accurately and with less effort than before. Increase safety while reducing bird strike incidents and expensive claims. Our drone detection systems enable you to take early control of drone hazards as they develop. Coordinate drone incidents with confidence and share clear and accurate threat location information with law enforcement agencies and other stakeholders. Reduce costly disruption and delays while increasing safety and security. Subscription-based pricing options available. Get in touch with us to find out more.
Rising air traffic volumes over the last decades puts increasing demands on reliable aeronautical information availability, which is often inaccurate, outdated, inconsistent, faulty, or hard to read, and so undermining the safety of civil aviation. NG Aviation supports the industry by the digitization of various aeronautical information, significantly increasing safety, improving data quality, and enhancing situational awareness. Its digital platform transforms previously scattered aeronautical information into a single comprehensive data source shared among all aviation stakeholders. NG Aviation gives all involved parties the possibility to speak the common language. Our platform significantly improves communication, information, and data exchange. So, for example, if a taxiway must be closed, all involved parties are notified via digital interface. Digital communication allows for clear, more effective, and safer airport operations. Digital data improves communication and navigation through complex airspaces. In case of closure due to military exercise or unexpected circumstances, stakeholders are notified in order to avoid any hazardous situation. The unexpected closure of a runway during the approach is not a problem anymore. Our platform shares the information immediately in a clear and visually understandable way. NG Aviation builds safer and more effective digital aviation of the future. Join the revolution now.
A powerful solution to the FOD problem, AFOD, is an electro-optical detection system supported with artificial intelligence, which is built to prevent the damage to airplanes and airports caused by foreign objects. Thoroughly inspecting airport runways, AFOD provides a constant flow of images and information to a central unit located at the control tower to be further processed by advanced AFOD algorithms. AFOD serves four main functions. By continuously inspecting airport runways, it detects FOD, specifying their location, size, number, and type of material. It also identifies wildlife presence, providing information as detailed as the species of the animal detected. It detects cracks and accumulation areas. It measures the depth of snow and thickness of ice.
Moog, we understand how costly foreign object debris can be, which is why we offer the Tarsier Automatic Runway FOD Detection System. In the 11 years since Tarsier was created, it has helped ensure 6 million plus FOD-free operations. It's the United States military's system of choice for FOD detection, and it can function in any and all weather conditions. The difference between Tarsier and manual FOD inspections is easy to see. Tarsier has proven that it detects all the FOD all the time, while manual inspections may miss items due to lighting conditions or the speed of a vehicle inspection. For over 65 years, Moog has been servicing the aircraft industry with innovative products and solutions. With the Tarsier Runway FOD Detection System, we're providing a solution that can generate revenue for your airport, prevent costly airport damage and lawsuits, and improve safety. Contact us